Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. All right, for 25th of February 2021. And these classes are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations, because you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs. All right, so it will be beneficial for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination, right? And for that you require to study or you read the daily national newspaper. You can read the daily national newspaper, okay, for these current affairs. For example, you must read the Hindu newspaper as well as the Indian Express, which will be very beneficial for you to study and prepare for the civil services examination. All right, you can also substantiate, also, you know, utilize our the basically channel on the YouTube Future IAS, where on the day-to-day basis we are bringing for you the daily current affairs. So you can subscribe our channel also on the YouTube and you will get the daily current affairs related news. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right, okay, so first news is related to the production linked incentive scheme for the pharmaceuticals. Okay, so here the government of India has basically started a scheme which is basically, you know, the production linked incentive scheme, right? So that the new players can be, you know, entered into the market, right? Also the investment also in the pharmaceutical sectors can also be increased. So it will be the production linked incentive scheme for the production of the pharmaceuticals. All right, so here the Union Cabinet have approved a new scheme which is basically related to the production linked incentive scheme, which will be provided certain incentives to the pharmaceutical companies over the period of from, say, over 9 years, from 2020-21 to 2028-29. So it will be for 9 years the incentive will be provided to the pharmaceutical industries for manufacturing of the pharmaceuticals. Okay, so here at one estimate the total incremental sale, okay, in between 2022 and 23 and 2027-28, the incremental sale would be around 2.94 lakh crore rupees from the manufacture or from the manufacturing of the pharmaceutical, and total incremental export, right, during this 6 years from 2022-23 to 2027-28, the total incremental export would be around 1.96 lakh crore rupees is estimated. So there is huge potential, right, specifically in the pharmaceutical industries. So the government has started the incentivize, you know, to those industries who can produce the pharmaceutical, and also the India will be self-sufficient in production of certain drugs which can be produced in, you know, some of the Western countries. So India can be self-sufficient in production of certain drugs. Okay, so the scheme will be expected to bring about investment of around 15,000 crore rupees in the pharmaceutical sector, that will be providing much financial assistance to the diversification of, you know, the pharmaceutical industries. Okay, and this scheme would be a part of the umbrella scheme for the development of the pharmaceutical industry. All right, the objective of this scheme would be to enhance the India's manufacturing capabilities. Obviously the first such objective would be, because if you incentivize certain sector, obviously you are incentivizing those manufacturing industries which are already in the fray or which are already in the system, right? So you are enhancing them, you are motivating them to further expand, to further diversify, right? Obviously by this process you are increasing the India's manufacturing capabilities. Obviously that will boost the investment and the production in the pharmaceutical sector, and obviously that will bring, you know, more diversification to the high value goods in the pharmaceutical sector. The target groups are those groups which will be incentivized and that will be targeted for such scheme. So here the targeted groups are basically the manufacturers of the pharmaceutical goods. Okay, so here the manufacturers of those pharmaceutical goods would be registered in India, right? These manufacturers would be, you know, grouped, right, which will be based on the global manufacturing revenue. So whichever the manufacturer who has the higher global manufacturing revenue, right, will have, right, will have the incentive based on that scheme. Okay, so that it, the group which is based on the global manufacturing revenue will have the wider applicability, like those groups will obviously will have the wider reach, wider applicability, and at the same time that group would be able to meet the desired objectives under the scheme. The quantum of the incentive, that means how much the incentive is, or how much the incentive will be provided to those the manufacturers. So here the total incentive would be around 15,000 crore rupees. Okay, that is inclusive of your administrative expenditure. Right, and it also, this scheme also categorizes the good. So this scheme shall cover the pharmaceutical goods under three such heads or three such categories. So first such category, that is category one, that include the following items. So first, biopharmaceuticals, complex generic disease drugs, the patented drugs or the drugs nearing patent expiry, the cell-based or the gene therapy drugs, the orphan drugs, special empty capsules like HPMC, Pululan, Entric, etc., and complex excipients, then phytopharmaceuticals and other drugs which are approved. So in the category one, these drugs will be there. In the category two, the active pharmaceutical ingredients or the key starting materials or the drug intermediates will be involved. Okay, in the category three, right, all other categories which are not involved or which are not incorporated in the category one and category two would be incorporated in the category third, drugs. Okay, so these category of the goods would be a part of this scheme, which will be, you know, able to incentivize those manufacturers for the production of such products related to the pharmaceuticals. All right. Next, the production linked incentive scheme for IT hardware. Okay, again, this is a production linked incentive scheme. Okay, the government is aiming to incentivize the IT hardware. IT hardware means, the hardware means something which you can touch, right, which you can feel. Okay, for example, you have the laptops, you have the tab, they are all considered as a IT hardware, the server related network. Okay, so that hardware that you basically touch. Okay, so all such tab, laptops, server related, you know, hardwares are all included into the IT hardware products. So here the government of India is also incentivizing, right, the production of those items which are related to the IT hardware. Again, the Union Cabinet, which is chaired by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, has approved the production linked incentive scheme for the manufacturing of the IT hardware in India. Right? Why we are, you know, enhancing, why we are production, why we are providing this incentive? Because now in India, right, we are import dependent on certain IT related hardwares. If we produce those things indigenously, that will cut down those imports of those materials, as well as we can also save our forex that would be basically used for the import of those items. Okay, so this scheme proposes the production linked incentive. Okay, so this scheme would have the production linked incentive. Okay, obviously the primary task is to boost the domestic production or domestic manufacturing, and the secondary aim is basically to attract larger investment, specifically in the IT hardware sector. Okay, next, the scheme will incentivize those manufacturers to the extent of 4% to 2% or 1% on the net incremental sale over the base year of 2019-20, right, based on that scheme, which will be, you know, goods which are manufactured in India, right, and also it will be applicable to those eligible companies for the period of 4 years. All right, next, this scheme is likely to benefit the five major global players. So under this ambit of this scheme, right, the government of India is primarily, you know, basically tasking the five major global players as well as the 10 domestic champions, specifically in the field of IT hardware manufacturing. So the scheme is likely to be benefit these five global players and 10 domestic champions, specifically in the IT, you know, manufacturing, and which include the manufacturing of the laptops, tablets, right, the PCs, personal computers, and the servers which are related to the IT hardware, you know, items. The financial implications related to these products would be very high. So the proposed scheme or the cost of the proposed scheme would be around 7,350 crore rupees. That 7,350 crore rupees would be spent over 4 years. Okay, and that include basically the outlay of around 7,325 crore rupees, and remaining 25 crore rupees would be spent on administrative charges related to that particular scheme. Okay, so here you can see this, the production incentive, right, or production linked incentive scheme for IT hardware. So it is basically to provide the impetus to the domestic manufacturing related to the IT hardware, and also simultaneously to attract the larger investment in the field of IT hardware value chain. Okay, now the target segment under this scheme would be the laptops, tablets, PCs, personal computers, and the servers which are related to the IT. And that scheme is going to be benefit, you know, 5 global major players as well as 10 domestic manufacturers which are basically in the already in the construction phase or already in the manufacturing phase of tablets, PCs, servers, and laptops. Okay. Next, the embargo lifted on the grant of the government business to the private banks. Now, let me give you a brief, you know, background about it. The government of India basically did not allow initially the private banks to, you know, doing certain government related banking transactions. Okay. Only the public sector banks initially were allowed to do certain government-related banking transactions. These government-related banking transactions are those transactions which are directly, you know, involvement of the government. For example, you have the tax-related transactions, you have the revenue payment facilities, you have the pension payments, you have the small saving schemes, okay? So only those, you know, which are involvement of the government-related transactions, only the public sector banks are allowed to participate, or only public sector banks were eligible to have those government related, you know, banking transaction facilities. But now the government of India has decided to lift the embargo, right, which is basically some sort of a ban on, you know, some sort of a, the grant of the government business to the private banks. Now the private bank, with the lifting of these sanctions or with the lifting of this restrictions on the private banks, now the private banks can also be participated in, you know, government related banking transactions like tax related transactions, revenue payment related transactions, pension payments, as well as the saving schemes related transactions. Okay, so here the private banks will be able to participate in such government related banking transactions also from now onward. So what is there is that now the government has lifted this ban or embargo on the private banks. Now there is no limitation or there is no bar on the RBI, right, for authorization. So RBI would authorize, right, those banks which can be involved in the conduct of government related banking transactions. Okay, now since the government has lifted this embargo on the private banks, now the Reserve Bank of India can basically, you know, have, or Reserve Bank of India has no such bar, right, on authorization of the private banks. Now the RBI can basically authorize any particular private bank which can involve in the conduct of government related banking transactions. All right, so here the government related banking transactions can be done by the private sector banks also with the authorization of RBI. Okay, so these government related banking transactions include the tax and other payments or revenue payments, the pension payments, as well as the small saving schemes. So only initially the public sector banks were allowed to have, you know, these banking transactions which were related to the government. Okay, now if you go to the brief timeline, in 2012 the finance ministry did not allow the private banks to participate in the government, you know, transactions, right, except the few one which has to be undertake such business for the 3 years. Then in 2015 the government again, you know, continued with this embargo or this sanction of not allowing the private sector banks, right, and it allowed only the private sector with the existing government agency business. Okay, so with that to be continued, right, without any fresh authorization to the private banks. Now this embargo have been completely lifted. Now the RBI can authorize any private banks to conduct any government business related to such transactions. Okay, now the undertaking which is basically related to the government agency business, now the RBI, you know, pays a commission to the banks. For example, if the private sector banks or public sector bank, anyway, any bank, if they are involved in government related transactions like the pay, like the transaction related to the taxes, the transaction related to, say, you know, say for example, revenue payment or pension payment or small savings certificate, you know, all such schemes. The RBI, which authorized such banks, would pay, right, a commission to the bank. So banks will have a certain commission based on which the banks will facilitate such transactions related to the government. Okay. Now, the central bank, which is the RBI, would carry out the general banking business of the central and the state government through, you know, the agency banks. These agency banks are, you know, authorized banks, which are authorized by the RBI for conducting this general banking business related to the state government and the central government. Now, the central government or the central banks basically would authorize these agency banks, which may be the public sector banks, and now the private banks also allow. Now the private banks are also allowed. Now the private banks also can participate under this general banking business of the government of India, okay, as well as the government of the state, which are basically, you know, appointed under Section 45 of the Reserve Bank of India Act 1935. So RBI Act 1935, Section 45 authorized, right, the central bank or RBI to authorize any bank, right, to conduct those business which were related to the central government or the state government. All right. Then conspiracy. Okay. So you have seen that a 22-year-old, the climate change activist Disha Ravi, which was arrested by Delhi police, okay, on the charges of criminal conspiracy against the government of India. Okay. So the charges which was brought against this 22-year-old, the climate change activist Disha Ravi, was that the Delhi police says that she was a part of larger conspiracy, right, which was related to the incitement of the violence in the National Capital Territory on January 26. You remember the January 26? Okay, the farmers, including some of the, you know, the extremist group, basically entered the Red Fort, and there was so much violence in Delhi. Okay, so the Disha Ravi was basically arrested, right, in the background of the inciting of this violence, specifically in the NCR region on January 26. Okay, an FIR was filed in a Delhi court, right, and Section 120A was, you know, but basically imposed on the Disha Ravi, which was related to the criminal conspiracy under IPC or Indian Penal Code. And this Section 120B also prescribes the punishment for the criminal conspiracy. Now what happens is this 22-year-old climate change activist now have been granted the bail, okay, by a trial court. And this trial court also rejected the Delhi police charge, which was related to the conspiracy to incite the violence in NCR region on January 26. Okay, now related to the Section 120A of IPC, okay, the IPC, which says that the criminal conspiracy, right, which is defined in the IPC or Indian Penal Code under Section 120A, says that this criminal conspiracy is an agreement between two or more persons, okay, that are willing to or that are going to commit some sort of a criminal offense, okay, and that offense would constitute an offense of criminal conspiracy. So this agreement is more important to prove that there was a criminal conspiracy. Okay, so now then agreement is necessary and sufficient to establish a charge of this criminal conspiracy under Section 120A of the Indian Penal Code. Okay, even if the actual criminal offense itself has not been committed. Okay, so that means if there is sufficient nexus, if there is sufficient agreement between, right, between the, you know, those accused, right, related to the incitement of that offense, even that the particular criminal offense itself has not been committed, it will be suffice to establish the charges. Okay, the criminal conspiracy is a basically substantive offense by itself. Now you must understand this Section 120A of IPC was added in 1913. It was added by the British. Okay, and this provision was specifically used by the Britishers, okay, to deal with the rising national sentiments in India. So on that time, okay, the Britishers basically used this section to target some of the nationalists who were basically inciting, right, the feelings against the Britishers regarding you know, the independence of country. So they were basically, you know, spreading that, you know, basically, you know, to do something to the country, to the motherland, for making the motherland, you know, to get independence. So to incitement of the violence, right, this section was basically used by, you know, by the Britishers at that point of the time. Okay. So she is basically Disharavi, who was granted bail by Delhi court, right, related to the January 26 violence that occurred in Delhi region. Okay. Next, the Kodo Kushi, then Karoshi, and Hikikomori. These are the terms which are basically used in the Japanese language. Okay. So don't worry about these terms. Let's try to understand what are these Japanese terms. So it is basically the Japanese words, or they are Japanese words. So again, you read Kodo Kushi, right? Then Karoshi and Hikikomori. These are the Japanese words. Now, what is happening is that in the Japan, right, because of the high longevity, okay, and because of, right, the culture of the loneliness, right, there were, you know, the cases related to the suicides have went up in first time in the 11 years. Okay. So the Japan appointed the minister of loneliness. So you can consider that a minister of the loneliness is appointed by the Japanese government. Okay. Why this minister was appointed? To look after the causes of the suicide, right, which went up in the Japan first time in 11 years. Okay. So the suicide rate went up. People committed suicide in the Japan, which were related to the issue of the loneliness. Okay. Now, a minister was basically appointed to look after such issue. For example, if you see the figure, the Japan suicide rate rose up in 2020, first in 11 years. In 2020, 20,919 people have committed suicide. Okay. According to the data released by the National Police Agency, and the most experts believe that the problem of the suicide in the Japan is related to the country's culture of loneliness. Okay. So it is the culture of the country which makes the person lonely, right? And which is the responsible for the making to commit, for the people to making, or no, for committing the suicide. Okay. Now, as you know that Japan has the aging population also. Aging means, right, the people which are in the age of 65 plus, right, which is the highest in any country. So Japan's aging population, so you can consider that 65 plus aged population in the Japan is around 20% of the Japan's population. Okay, Japan's population. So 20% of the Japan's population is 65 plus. Okay, now you can consider that 25% of this one, as well as some middle-aged person also. Okay, along with this old age person, there is a huge people which are in the age bracket of this, or which are in this category. Now they feel very lonely, and also no one would generally go to help them, okay, for their company, for their companionship, and these people are most likely to commit suicide, or even they die. Okay, their death will be revealed after a few days, right? It because of, right, longevity, because of the culture of the loneliness which are there in the Japan. Now let's understand these terms. The first term is called Kodo Kushi, which means a lonely death. Now what happens is the aged people, or the people which are 65 plus, okay, as you know that the situation is universal in almost every country. The people which are in the 60 plus age category, now they generally do not socialize. And moreover, in the Japan, the culture of loneliness also made them, right, to separate, right, to remain lonely, right, not to socialize much. Okay. And what happens is many of these aged people die alone in their home, in their somewhere. Okay. And their bodies, you know, discovered, or bodies later found after a long period of the time after their death. So this phenomena of recovering their body after their death, after a few days, is known as Kodo Kushi, which is lonely death. Lonely death, that means a very simple, the person is dying alone, okay, without any information or without noticing to anyone, okay, and the person's body is basically recovered after a few days. So that phenomena in the Japanese language is known as the Kodo Kushi, or that is lonely death. Okay, Second word that is called karoshi. Karoshi means death due to overwork. Okay. As you know that Japanese people are very, very hard worker. Okay. They are very efficient in their working. Okay. They use, right, very small space to work. For example, their offices are not, you know, luxurious, or their offices are not that very big. So they use every inch of the space for the betterment, and they are very laborious and the hard worker also. Now, the culture of hard worker had made the people to work for the longest hours in the work. That means their work culture is so much, workaholic, that they used to work for the longer working hours or for the longer period of the time in a per day basis. Okay. Now, what happens is, if the person is, for example, working for 11 hours or 12 hours per day or 10 hours per day even, right, the person will not be having enough time, right, or enough opportunity to spend some time with their friends, with their, with their family members, as well as engaging in the hobbies also. Now, what will happen is the person would be cut out from such, social bonding. Now, what will happen? There will be a sudden occupational mortality. Okay. Now, this has led to the death of the person, right, which is related to the death due to the overwork. So that is in the Chinese language, in the Japanese language, that is called karoshi. That is called karoshi. That means the death occur of that person due to the overwork. Okay. Next is the hikikomori. The hikikomori, again, is the Japanese word. It means that what happens is the culture of self-isolation. Okay. So culture of self-isolation, which is basically, you can say that the hermits matlab sadhus, right? What the sadhus used to do, right? If you remember, they used to go to the jungles. Okay. They spend their entire remaining time of their life in the jungle by meditation, by doing certain other, the pujas and all sort of the things, but they are not involved socially with the people, okay, or with the society. So what happens is the culture of self-isolation is also very extreme in the Japan. Okay. Now what happens is if the culture is very extreme in the sense of the self-isolation, the people would generally go to the, for example, to the, self-imposed confinement, okay, where they will not be known, right, for the few years, okay, and there will be no contact with the outside world also. So that the modern day hermits type situation, right, for the years together, right, has led to the death of the people sometime, and that is called hikikomori. So that phenomena is called hikikomori, okay. All three has caused, right, certain deaths in the Japan also. Okay. Then the court etiquette. Okay. So as you know, the etiquettes. Okay. So here what happens is, as we go inside the court, we use the word, my lord, your honor. Okay. Your lordship. Okay. So we used to say to the court or the judge, your honor, right, your lordship, my lord. But what happens is, right, a law student, okay, who was basically present in front of the Chief Justice of India, okay, the law student basically, addressed the judge as your honor, okay, and it was intervened, right, on February 23rd by a Supreme Court bench, which is headed by the Chief Justice of India, S.A. Bovde, okay. Now, S.A. Bovde, who is the Honorable Chief Justice of India, has asked the petitioner not to use the word your honor, okay, because it triggered the debate, and it was not a new debate, it was somewhat older only, right. The judge or the Chief Justice of India, S.A. Bovde, again says that if you use this word your honor or your lordship, what will happen, you are actually associating us with the Supreme Court of United States of America, right, or you are associating with something which is magistrate that was there, during the British time. Okay. Now, we are neither the United States of America, we are neither the British or British magistrate. Okay. Now, the Chief Justice of India told the petitioner, which was a law student, not to use such terms while coming to the court. Okay. Now, for many years, there was many effort, right, from the judges also to stop this protocol, which is a salutation which will be used in the court of the law, right, to purse that, right, a salutation, right, specifically the my lord and your lordship, right, which were related to the practice which was you know inherited from the British rule. Now, related to the legal provisions, the Advocate Act of 1961, basically under section 49(1)(c) empowers the Bar Council of India to make rules, okay, which will be used for the professional and adequate standards, which will be observed by the advocates while presenting certain case in front of the court of the law. Okay, so this Advocate Act 1961 prescribe, right, to make certain rules which can be used as an adequate standard or professional standard which can be used in the court of the law. Okay, now to address this issue of telling your magistrate, your lord, my lord, and something like that, a resolution was passed by the Bar Council of India, because Advocate Act 1961, right, empowered the Bar Council of India to make the rules. So in that aspect, the Bar Council of India has passed a resolution, okay, in 2006, and which added a chapter called 3A to part 6 of the Bar Council of India rules of stopping that practices in the court of the law. Okay, now 2006 notification discouraged the use my lord, your lordship, okay, in the court of the law, right? It prescribed that you can use your honor or honorable court, right, as an acceptable way of addressing the Supreme Court and High Court. So whenever you go to the Supreme Court and High Court, you can say your honor and honorable court. And if you are presenting your case in the subordinate courts or in the tribunal, you can use sir, you can use sir. So this notification basically provides, right, all sort of a professional standard which can be used in the court of the law. So he is basically our Honorable Supreme Court, Honorable Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, which is S.A. Bovde. Okay. Next, the jaws of life. The jaws of life, again, it is, you know, associated with, you know, the safeguarding the life of a person which were basically, you know, going to be lost during the accident. So what happens is, if you have seen the collisions, right, of the vehicles, especially on the road, right, the, you know, very heavy collision, what happens is that make the vehicle, you know, to twist into, you know, into very critical or very crucial. So what happens is the bodies or the person basically, you know, they generally do not come out of that damaged cars. So they were stuck inside the damaged cars after collision. So the jaws of the life basically used to cut down that damaged car. It is basically an hydraulic tool. It is basically an hydraulic tool, okay, which is basically used to evacuate the person from the damaged cars. Okay. Now what happens is, a golfing legend, a Tiger Woods, right, who was, you know, met with a tragic accident, a car accident in the Southern California, and which has caused him the multiple injuries. Now, initially the report, you know, came out that, you know, the paramedic basically used this jaws of life to cut down and to extricate the athlete from the vehicle. Okay. But later it was confirmed that, the wood was removed from the wreckage using other tools, not by the jaws of life. Okay. So later it was confirmed that the jaws of life, which is the hydraulic tool, which was not used for the wood's rescue. Okay. Now, the jaws of life is basically a hydraulic extinction rescue tool, okay, extrication rescue tool, where, you know, in the case of, you know, emergency situations, specifically in the crashes or collisions, right, this tool is basically used to evacuate the person. Okay, so now, the most often used to pull the drivers, passengers who got stuck and sometimes dead in the vehicles, right, out of the damaged vehicles after severe traffic collisions. Okay, these, you know, the hydraulic spread cutter was invented by the George Hurst in 1961, and it has four major parts or four major components. The first is cutter, spreader, rams, and the power source, okay, which is basically used for evacuation of the people who got stuck during the severe collisions, right, in the car accidents or maybe some accident which is related to the road accident. All right. So you can see it is the jaw of life, which is used to evacuate the body. It is hydraulic cutter also. Okay. Next, the Kirby insurgency. So all you know that a Kirby is basically a major ethnic community in the state of Assam. Okay, so Karbi is a basic ethnic community in the state of Assam. Now, the five militant outfits which were related to the Karbi, you know, ethnic community has recently surrendered, right, in front of the chief minister of Assam. So what happens is around 1,000 militant which were related to the five insurgency group or five militant groups of the Karbi Anglong district, right, which is basically, you know, the insurgency hit district in the Assam state. The 1,000 militants basically, you know, surrendered in presence of the chief minister of the Assam. Okay, these Karbi insurgent or the militants were basically comprised of the cadres of the five outfits. Okay, the first outfit is Karbi People's Liberation Tiger, that we call KPLT, that People's Democratic Council of Karbi Longri, that is PDCK, then Karbi Longri NC Hills Liberation Front, that is KLNLF, then Kuki Liberation Front, KLF, and United People's Liberation Army, that is UPLA. So the five cadres of the Kargi, of the Karbi militant groups basically surrendered, okay, in a public ceremony. Now, the Karbi is basically the major ethnic community in the Assam, and which has basically, you know, have the long insurgency history, which is continuously demanding, right, a separate state, which should be carved out from the existing Assam. And this insurgency is basically started since 1980s. Okay. Now, the originated from a core demand of forming the separate state, which will be only, you know, made up of the Karbi, you know, ethnic community, which were residing in the Assam region. Now, the government of India has accepted the demand of the Karbi ethnic community and formed the Karbi Anglong, you know, Autonomous Council. The Karbi Anglong Autonomous Council is basically an autonomous district council, right, which were protected under sixth schedule. Sixth schedule is something which is related to, right, which is related to the tribal areas, right, schedule areas, right, so which were protected under the sixth schedule and also have given certain administrative and executive powers and financial powers to that autonomous council. Now, the entire political discourse in this constituency comprises of the three districts of the Assam. You can see the first district was basically the Karbi Anglong. This Karbi Anglong in 2016 was splitted into the Karbi Anglong and West Karbi Anglong. Okay, now the Karbi Anglong, West Karbi Anglong, and Bima Hasao, these are the three districts which were demanding for the granting of the autonomous state status to the region. Okay, now the region which were basically inhabited by the ethnic community of Karbi, now this should be granted the autonomous status. And the second is more autonomy and the power of the Karbi Anglong Autonomous Council, as well as the North Kachar Hills Autonomous Council, which is basically administering the Bima Hasao district, should be granted. So ultimate their demand is to grant more autonomy, to grant more autonomous state status to the region, and to grant more power in terms of administrative and executive power so that it can autonomously run and, you know, execute their policies specifically in the Karbi Anglong region. Okay, so here you can see the Assam, it is the Brahmaputra River which used to flow, it is the Meghalaya, and I'm talking about this Karbi Anglong group, which is basically, you know, having the insurgency hit area. Okay, and this is also, you have the district which is also the Karbi Anglong hit insurgency state. Okay, next, the housework compensation. As you know, that China is a communist regime, okay, with a very poor track record of human rights, okay, the very poor track records of the individual rights in the China. But what happens is China has brought, you know, some sort of a new civil code, or China enforced a new civil code, and which basically enforceable within the mainland of China. Now, what happens is a landmark judgment which was delivered, right, in a Beijing court, in a divorce court in the Beijing, which ordered the husband to compensate his ex-wife for the household work she did during the 5 years of the marriage. That means the divorce court in the Beijing has ordered the husband to pay for his wife, okay, for 5 years of compensation that she worked, right, during her matrimonial life in you know, in his home as the wife, right, during the divorce proceedings. So that is something which is to be understood, right, that the Beijing has understood the human rights which were related to the rights of individual. Now, the court further ordered that a joint property which were related to the husband should be splitted into equal two parts, because the husband property should be splitted, right, and ordered to pay around $7,700 to the wife, right, as a compensation for the household work that she did during the 5 years of the marriage. Okay, now the January 1, the Chinese government brought and enforced the new civil code, which will be applicable on the mainland of China, right, and which will provide some sort of a protection to the individual rights. Now, because of poor track records of the human rights and other, you know, this uniform civil code would give certainly, you know, the hope for the greater, you know, human rights, specifically on the mainland China. Okay, now before the new law came into the force, such compensation would be demanded only in the case which were related to the prenuptial agreement, which was signed itself, which was also uncommon practice in the China. Okay. Next, the Narendra Modi Stadium. Already you know that the Motera Stadium, which is the world's largest cricket stadium, okay, which is already named as Sardar Patel Stadium, now has been recently renamed as the Narendra Modi Stadium. Okay. So now the Motera Stadium have been renamed from the Sardar Patel Stadium to the Narendra Modi Stadium. Okay. Now, this Motera Stadium is a cricket stadium which is located in the Ahmedabad, Gujarat. Okay. The India's test against the England is the first match at the brand new Motera Stadium, which will be taken place. Okay. And it has the sitting capacity of 1,10,000, right? So it has the sitting capacity of 1,10,000 people at a time, which makes the Motera Stadium as a world largest stadium in terms of the sitting capacity. Okay, in terms of the name change from Sardar Patel Motera Stadium to Narendra Modi Stadium, now this is not a new practice. The naming of a particular place after the politician, which is a decade old practice in India. Okay, specifically in every field you might have seen. For example, the Brandbord Stadium in the Mumbai, the Wankhede Stadiums in the Mumbai, both were named after the person when those person were basically alive on that time. Okay, and for example, you can say the D.Y. Patil Stadium in the Mumbai, then M. Chinnaswamy Stadium in the Bengaluru, and M. E. Chidambaram Stadium in the Chennai were also named after the important personalities or politician figure. Okay, even Mohali's PCA Stadium was named after the BCCI and Punjab Cricket Association President I.S. Bindra in 2015. And now, very recently in 2019, after the death of Arun Jaitley, the Firoz Shah Kotla Stadium in Delhi was renamed as the Arun Jaitley Stadium, right, which is also in favor of a particular important personality. So that shows that renaming of a particular stadium or, you know, a particular place in the name of a politician who is basically alive is not a new tradition in India. It was done also before also. All right. So it is a view of the Motera Stadium, which are recently named as Narendra Modi Stadium. All right. So thank you very much for this. So those who attended this class, thank you very much for attending this class. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.